And joining us now via Zoom for more details about his phone call with his American counterpart, we have Philippine Defense Chief Delfin Lorenzana. Secretary Lorenzana, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen.
Good morning to you. So, Secretary, can you share with us some points on what was covered in your phone conversation? How long was your conversation with your counterpart?
It was very short, Karen. I think not more than 15 minutes. It was just a get-to-know-you introductory phone call. But we also touched some important matters like the BFA, the situation in South China Sea. He also mentioned about their support on the arbitral ruling and their policy that this should be a free and unimpeded Indo-Pacific region or South China Sea, especially.
Okay.
So I think that's the gist. I also mentioned to him our yearly military exercises like the Balikatan, which will resume sometime this May. It was suspended last year, so hopefully we can resume again this May.
All right. Let's talk about the visiting forces agreement first, since this was mentioned. Does this mean, Secretary, we know that first the visiting forces agreement was canceled, and then the cancellation was suspended. Would you now push for a permanent resumption? Kumbaga status quo. Just resume the VFA permanently as is.
Correction, Karen.
Terminated.
There was only a notice of termination because there is a provision in the agreement that 60 days notice is required for one party to tell the other that the agreement is terminated. So it was just a notice for 6 months, which was suspended by the president twice already. And the second suspension will end, I think, August 6, 2021. So we have less than 6 months to go.
Okay, so yun na nga, if the second termination will end August 2021, and Austin reiterated the importance of the VFA, would you then push, in effect, that that determination, for example, be cut earlier?
The final decision to push through the termination or withdraw the notice, Karen, rest on the president.
Yes, definitely.
However, we at we at the Defense Department and the Armed Forces, the general feeling in the Armed Forces is for the VFA to continue.
Yeah. How important is the visiting forces agreement really for the Philippines at this point? Really, with China's new threat.
The visiting forces agreement, when it was signed in 1999 or 2000, I don't think the purpose there is to contain or to face China's threat in the South Pacific, in the South China Sea. There was no threat then, and the main purpose of the visiting forces agreement was for these two countries, the two militaries of these countries, to keep on developing doctrines, joint doctrines, interoperability in support of the mutual defense treaty. I think that's the main purpose of the visiting forces agreement.
Yes, but then the visiting forces agreement clearly makes the implementation of the mutual defense treaty more solid because it solidifies the you said it, the interaction between both countries.
That's correct. That's correct. We work together. Our militaries exercise, develop doctrines on joint operations on interoperability. Our men also in the military are able to see some of the new equipment. they also familiarized with the new equipment, and in the process, the military also decides on the basis of their experience with the new equipment if they will buy or not. So it actually improves our capabilities as well by exercises and by having experience on the new weapons.
Yes. And given China's new statements on fire at will, right, with foreign vessels, do you see now that there is, do you see the need to strengthen the relationship with the United States, a long-standing ally, more important than ever, Secretary?
Our relations with the U.S. Canon has always been strong. Whoever sits there, Republican or Democrat, I think it doesn't change. It hasn't changed. Maybe the degree of implementation of their policy will vary, but their foreign policy remains the same. Mm-mm. And we hope that, we expect that the policies of the Biden administration will follow or will be the same as Trump's administration, with some changes, small changes. Mm-mm. But their policy here in the Indo-Pacific region remains the same.
Bo-oh.
Now, you said, do we have to strengthen our relations with our allies? I think there is no need to do that because it has always been strong. And our friends in the region, like Japan, Korea, New Zealand, Australia, and the ASEAN countries are all in support of a peaceful and stable Indo-Pacific region.
Yes.
But now, we also have to nurture our relationship with China. China is a very close neighbor, and we have a lot of engagement with them, especially trade. And we cannot choose between the two.
Yes.
I said we should not be made to choose between supporting the U.S. or supporting China. I think we should balance our relationships with them.
Yes. So that's a good one. So balance our relationship with them. But given China's new statement, the U.S. has given the clear commitment with a mutual defense treaty in the event of. In other words, if China makes real its threat of firing at a foreign vessel, if it is a vessel from the Philippines, the Mutual Defense Treaty is activated. Even Secretary de Teddy Loxin said that. So, number one, the Philippines did, for example, we suspended the Visiting Forces Agreement twice now, and the Philippines also did not participate in the naval drills with the United States as to not offend China, no less than you had said that before in an interview. So we did take a backseat. We took a step back with the U.S.
Yeah, because we do not want to exacerbate the situation in the South China Sea, Karen. Our relationship with China has always been, since President Duterte became president, it's always been cordial and friendly. Mm-mm. And we don't want to muddle the issue there. As I said a while ago, they are our close neighbor, and we have a lot of interactions with them, especially trade. So. Now, the main reason why we did not participate in the exercises in the South China Sea with the U.S. and all the allies is because we did not have the equipment to match what they are doing there.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, we have frigates, but they are not armed. We have ships, but they are not also armed. So I think, it is to their interest, maybe.
Mm-mm.
Why they are doing these exercises in the South China Sea to keep the South China Sea open for commercial and some innocent navigation.
Mm-mm.
So that's the reason why we did not want to participate. Firstly, is not to antagonize China, because China is watching us here, and a lot of things could be done to us by the Chinese government if we are antagonized. And the U.S. keep coming to the South China Sea, even if without our knowledge. In fact, two career groups of the U.S. Navy is conducting the freedom of navigation in the South China Sea at the moment. And did we know that they're coming? No, we did not. Because to them that is a traditional shipping lanes, and it is open to all. So they can do practically anything they want there in South China Sea.
Yeah. Now, recently, when Biden was inaugurated as Secretary Lorenzana, the U.S. and China actually did naval drills together. Am I correct? Just recently?
The U.S. and China?
Together, yeah.
The last RIMPAC, the RIMPAC in Hawaii last year, China wasn't invited.
Okay, I'll get to that detail later on. But what I was moving to is if China and the U.S. could do it together, is now that we have two frigates that have arrived, does this mean that you would recommend that we join naval drills with the U.S., the next naval drills in the South China Sea? Would that benefit the Philippines?
Karen, traditionally, or I think yearly, we have this passage exercise with the U.S. Navy. Our Philippine Navy have this exercise with the U.S. Navy within our territorial waters or within the 12-mile limit. And they do this every year. We just avoid going with them in the disputed islands, in the disputed area. But we can do exercise with them within maybe within the territorial waters of the Philippines, especially in the Solo Seas. Wag na muna doon sa disputed area kasi it tries the tension on both sides. Maybe all the claimants there also will be alarmed that a lot of exercises are going on there. Mm-mm. And as much as possible, I would not like, as the Defense Secretary, I would not like to be involved there, because if it's a shooting war, erupts. And I told Secretary Austin yesterday that we don't want anything, miscalculations or accidents happening in the South China Sea, because we are right smack there in the center of the conflict. Kung mayari yan, ano? Tayo talaga ang kawawa dyan. So it is to our interest to pursue a stable and peaceful South China Sea.
Mm-mm. I see. So talagang it is a policy that even after China's recent statement that if the Philippines joins naval drills, it will not be in the contested waters.
Yes. That was enunciated also by the president in 2016 when he said no more exercises in the South China Sea. But within our territorial waters, in the 12-mile limit, I think we can do that. Mm. And within the Solo Sea, which is actually inside our territory.
Okay. All right. Will this be part of the plans that you'll be discussing with Secretary Austin?
Yeah, we agreed to meet again, if possible, face-to-face. I ask him if he visits the region in the near future to come visit Manila, so that we could talk more and discuss more the bilateral relations between our two countries. And there is one event that is coming up sometime in November, the ADMM Plus of the ASEAN. And we also agreed to meet there if the meeting and face-to-face meeting will push through.
Okay.
So a lot of things, wala pa, marami pa kami pag-uusapan. I think he still also feeling his way around. It was just confirmed last January 22, so I believe that he's just feeling his way around, talking to his counterparts in the region like he did with me.
Okay. So part of the discussion also with Secretary Austin, you said, was the importance of enhancing increasing interoperability between the two militaries through a variety of bilateral security cooperation activities. One question then is the Philippines now open to having U.S. maritime patrol aircrafts stationed in Philippine bases so they can fly over the South China Sea when needed?
I think that is not part of the visiting forces agreement for them to station reconnaissance plane that will solely patrol the South China Sea. Sometimes they come here, but only briefly, sometimes a couple of days. They do surveillance there in the contested area, but they do not stay here long, just very briefly. But for them to station permanently those assets, I think it's no longer allowed by our constitution.
Okay, all right. The latest Chinese threat, was that mentioned at all in the phone call, Secretary?
No, it was not, Karen. It was not mentioned. The threat of the coast guards of the Chinese firing at foreign vessels?
Mm-mm.
No. It was not mentioned at
okay.
all.
Okay. Now, you mentioned earlier, in an earlier interview, you said you're very concerned with the China statement because it might cause miscalculations and accidents there, right? You said that, sir?
Yeah, I said that. I said that, I think, a couple of days back. Yes.
Yeah. And what action will we take to ensure that it doesn't happen to our fishermen? Because you also did say it doesn't concern our fishermen because they're not armed. But then you also said you're concerned about miscalculations.
The miscalculations, Karen, involves warships, you know? Naval ships, Coast Guard ships, because the Chinese has deployed quite a number of Coast Guard ships and maritime militia ships in the South China Sea, excluding the naval ships, the Navy ships. You know? And the miscalculation that I am talking about is the miscalculation that will happen between other nations like the US and other countries who would like to patrol in the area. Mm-hmm. I am not at all concerned about our fishermen being fired upon by the Coast Guard because they know our fishing boats are not armed, so I'm not concerned. I'm not also concerned that the Chinese Coast Guard will fire upon our Coast Guards. They know that is a contested area. We claim that as well, and we claim that's why we are talking to resolve this. Conflicting claims in the area. So, wala akong takot yan. Even our naval ships, when they patrol the area, I don't think the Chinese will fire at our naval ships.
Ba-o.
Ang takot ko lang, yung iba, the other nations, the other navies of the nation, magkaroon ng shooting war. And if that happens because of the MDT, we will be involved whether we like it or not.
Do you plan to dialogue with your Chinese counterpart, Secretary?
We had twice talked already, Karen, one through a phone call sometime in May and last October or June. Late last year, the Chinese Minister of Defense came here to visit me. Mm-hmm. And we talk about range, a lot of things, a lot of issues concerning the South China Sea.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a very robust dialogue with the Chinese defense minister.
Mm-mm. Okay, all right. I just like to correct myself also and clarify, as Secretary, with what we were discussing earlier. The recent naval drills in the South China Sea by the U.S. after the Biden inauguration was with Japan, Australia, India, and two U.S. Navy ships. So that at least that's clear during this interview. Thank you for that, sir. Thank you. Now, moving back, you said the two frigates, or the AFP chief said the two frigates would be used to protect our fishermen. That is correct?
The primary agency that will protect our fishermen current are the Coast Guard, the Philippine Coast Guard. They have also quite a number of vessels that they can deploy in the South China Sea or in the West Philippine Sea to protect our fishermen. Now, the Navy ships will be there to patrol as well, and they will be also used to protect our fishermen so that they can go to their traditional fishing ground like Scarborough Shoal in Reed Bank and Mischief Reef without any interference from other countries.
Okay, so let's be specific about this. The Philippine Navy's brand new warships, what will be their assignments? Will they be patrolling the South China Sea as a whole, I mean the contested waters, just to increase Philippine presence in the area?
That will be one of their duties, Karen, but the South China Sea or the West Philippines is not the only areas that they will patrol. We have the Solo Seas, where we are also very concerned about the egress and ingress of terrorists from Sabah and Indonesia. We also have the Bintam Rise and the East Philippine Sea, which is also vast, that we need also huge vessels because of the turbulent seas there. Hindi pwede yung maliliit na barko dyan, so malalaki lang kailangan natin. So, they have a very wide range of activities that is facing them. That's why we are still planning to acquire more vessels for our Navy.
Mm-mm. How can we increase, okay, in terms of acquiring more vessels for our Navy, Secretary Locsin said, we are rearming. Those are the words that he used. Now, we are rearming under this administration. So we now have two new warships. What else are we expecting, Secretary?
Well, we are, the Navy wants to have the offshore patrol vessels. Mm-hmm. I think there's a plan to order five offshore patrol vessels, smaller ones, but nevertheless still Navy ships, and two corvettes. So that's in the planning board. Hopefully we can have them already ordered soon. Mm-mm. Otherwise, we will wait for the next administration to do that.
Okay. The Philippines recently received, and you can correct me if this needs updating, $29 million in U.S. military assistance. Is that correct? That was the latest aid we received from the U.S.?
Yeah, this assistance consists of a lot of equipment, anti-terrorist equipment, rifles. It includes also some drones, the unmanned aerial vehicles for surveillance.
Okay. And are you expecting more? Are we expecting more assistance from the Biden administration?
I have not heard of any new grants to us, Karen. We'll see. We'll ask our ambassador in the U.S., Abe Romualdez, if there are funds in the pipeline to be given to us.
Okay. Now, my last question on this issue is the Philippines has tried to repeatedly appease China in the sense of not to worsen tensions in the area. And yet China comes out with statements like, we'll fire at foreign vessels. In other words, do you believe China is doing their share, their part in this whole situation? Secretary Locsin says they're delaying the code of conduct as well. So isn't it time for the Philippines, one would say, to also build stronger ties with the U.S., that's a longtime ally, that clearly, with the mutual defense treaty, have the need and the access for defense when needed?
Karen, I think the word appease is not correct there. Mm. We're not appeasing China. We are trying to develop relationships with all countries around the region. Mm-mm. We're not appeasing anybody. Our relationships with the U.S. has always been strong. The people-to-people relationship is very strong, in fact, and we still have a huge trading amount of trades with them every year, and a lot of things. So the U.S. and the Philippines will always be allies here in the region. I think people will just twist some words and say, inaapis natin yung China, hindi natin nilalabanan. But we are doing a lot of things there. Mm-mm. Through our foreign affairs department, Secretary Loxin has been working overtime to maintain peace and stability in the region, especially in the West Philippine Sea, and dealing with the Chinese. Hindi naman tama yon na sasabihin apis, because I've come out with strong words also against the Chinese, and they reacted accordingly. Mm-mm. And the ambassador, the former ambassador, keep telling me that I should not say those words because they have constituencies at home. Sabi ko naman, bakit? Ikaw lang ba may constituency? Ako mayroon din ako dito sa Pilipinas, and they're watching me, what I say, what is happening there. And if there are provocations there, I will speak against those provocations.
Mm-mm. Okay, with our fishermen, just recently you said, of course, just the last, fishermen are not armed, and you advise them to continue fishing in their traditional fishing grounds like Scarborough Shoal, Reed Bank, and Mischief Reef, because those are traditional fishing grounds of Filipinos, correct? Senator Risa Ontiveros issued a statement and has called on you to stop downplaying China's abusive behavior. That was, in effect, the content, no, more or less, of her statement. Is it time to already come to an agreement with China, sit with China, and already negotiate exactly on when it comes to respect for fishermen coming from both countries? Because reports have it that when Chinese fishermen go to Scarborough Shoal, they come in with large fishing boats that are technically Chinese militia. I mean, that's what reports say. So is it time to sit and agree on essentially countries' behaviors with fishing vessels?
I think that's the purpose of the code of conduct, Karen. Mm. That's why we want the code of conduct to be finished soon. While President Xi Jinping told the president about 2 years ago that that he wants the code of conduct finished before the end of President Duterte's term, I think it has not moved far. That is the lament of Secretary Loxin. Na medyo dinidribble-dribble nila yung code of conduct. I don't know what is the purpose of the Chinese by doing that, but we really want those code of conduct to be finished, because that will set the rules on the conduct of all vessels, civilian vessels, naval vessels in the West Philippine Sea or South China Sea. So that's where we are now, and Secretary Loxin, I am sure, will be working hard for the completion of the code of conduct in the South China Sea.
Okay, and my last question on this, I'm sorry, is your reaction to Senator Risa Ontiveros saying and calling on you to stop downplaying the threat of the China Coast Guard law?
What does she mean by downplaying?
I think that you had said that it doesn't concern our fishermen. In other words, they're not in danger in this particular law, with this particular law.
That is not downplaying, Karen. That is just stating the fact. I don't think the Chinese will fire at an armed vessel.